What's up, NBA fans? Dom2K on the mic, and I just got back from out of town, so I didn't exactly have time to work on the video that I had planned to come out today. Instead, I thought this was the perfect time to put out a commentary that I had actually been planning for a while. It just kind of got lost in everything else that I do in life. But it's a topic that I kind of want to pose as a question, and I'm going to talk about. So, as you can see from the title, the topic today is, and I'm going to ask you guys this, should NBA players be loyal to teams? And this is the perfect time to have this conversation because obviously this summer we had the whole shitstorm with Kevin Durant leaving the Oklahoma City Thunder to join the Golden State Warriors, and he's basically just said, you know, I'm going to win rings, screw everything else, and he's took control of his destiny. And we're seeing this more and more often where it seems like players don't really care for playing for the team that drafted them. You know, they want to go elsewhere and they want to try to win an NBA championship. And so I think we saw that with LeBron when he first left Cleveland to Miami, and then he went from Miami back to Cleveland. And it just seems like a really common theme. Now, what I want to do is put all of us in the shoes of an NBA superstar who's 7 years into his career, has not won a championship with the team that drafted him, and much like LeBron, he has a chance to go, you know, form a team elsewhere that could pretty much win a championship. And let's look at, you know, from that player standpoint, if you're sitting in that superstar's shoes, what are your incentives to be loyal to an NBA franchise? Now, if you're looking at this from the NBA player standpoint, you might say, well, all the best players, you know, the guy that top 1% who all have left lasting legacies have played their entire career with one team. And just to rattle off some names, Kobe Bryant, Tim Duncan, Dirk Nowitzki, Larry Bird, Magic Johnson. These guys that are just synonymous with NBA greatness have all stayed on one team. They have one jersey. And that's great because when you end your career, there's absolutely no question that that gets you brownie points, you know? It gets you brownie points to say you stuck through the hard times and, you know, you took pay cuts for your team and you won championships with them and you did everything for the city and everything is fine, dandy, you have a decorated career. But ask yourself this if you're that superstar. What happens if I stay loyal to this franchise and that doesn't happen? What if I turn into one of the guys like Patrick Ewing, who, yes, I'm well aware he did play for the Magic at the end of his career, but let's pretend that didn't happen. He spent pretty much the whole thing with the Knicks. Karl Malone, John Stockton, all these great guys who stayed in one place, but, you know, you can say all these things about their career. They scored so many points and did so many great things. Hall of Fame, you know, dream teamers. But they never won an NBA championship. And a lot of those guys, you look at them and say they were victim to Michael Jordan's success. And what if you become that guy who was a victim to other players' success who took control of their careers and dominated the NBA while you decided you were going to be loyal? And guess what? Depending on where you play, you very well might end up one of those players, a victim to being loyal. Now, if you guys follow Gilbert Arenas on Instagram, you see a lot of funny shit. That's why his Instagram is named No Chill IG. But every once in a while, you know, once in a blue moon, he posts just straight up facts. He goes on rants and he just posts straight up facts sometimes. And he posted facts when he talked about Kevin Durant going to the Warriors. And basically his point was, you know, you guys don't pay attention to the business side a lot of the NBA. And the harsh reality that a lot of fans choose to ignore because they just love to talk shit about players and rag on player decisions is that a lot of these teams don't care about winning an NBA championship. I know we love the NBA and we love stories and success, but a lot of the owners of teams could care less if their team ever won an NBA championship. Let me give you guys an example if you don't believe me. Back in like the 2000s somewhere, Mark Cuban got sued by one of the other owners of the Dallas Mavericks, who I believe was probably a minority owner. He got sued because that owner's complaint was Mark Cuban can't make this team profitable, can't pay off his debts. And Mark Cuban was like, chill, you know, everybody's going to be paid on time like they always are. But in that, Mark Cuban also said, you know, that this guy, I believe his name was Ross, the other owner. And Mark Cuban said that, you know, this guy could care less about the Mavericks fans. He could care less about winning. And what he was alluding to is Mark Cuban, you know, he's a huge basketball fan, which is a big reason why he's one of the only owners you really know by name and face. It's because he's always out there. Mark Cuban wants to win, and he wants to pay a team to win, right? Not every owner is like him, you know. A lot of owners, really, they don't have the same love and share the same love for basketball that the fans share. So if they have a guy like a Kevin Durant or a Carmelo Anthony, you know, people that you're going to come out to watch every night, and they're going to sell jerseys and they're going to sell tickets, some of these owners, they just sit back and go like, well, shit, you know, I'm making money off this guy. Why do I need to pay a team to try to go win a championship? Because, well, then we're probably not going to be profitable. It costs money, man. Like, you look at the Cavaliers, right? I'm pretty sure they have, like, the highest payroll in the NBA right now or something, and they just won an NBA championship, but they had to pay like crazy to win that NBA championship, didn't they? And you look at it, not every team is willing to do that. And that's why, you know, in your lifetime, it seems like the same teams always suck, and it seems like the same teams are always competing for a championship. Give you an example. In my lifetime, it's always been the Lakers, the Spurs, Miami, sometimes the Celtics. Obviously, you know, a lot of their success goes back years, but you got teams like those who are always in the running for a championship, always contending, always trying to do what they need to do to build the next team that can win a championship. And then you have teams like the Bucks and the Nuggets who are just like, sometimes they're in the ballpark of the playoffs. Maybe once in a blue moon, they're in the contention for an NBA championship, but they're never champions, and they're pretty much never close to being NBA champions. And what Gilbert Arenas said was so true that, hey, you know, these owners, they don't, it's a business, man. They're trying to make money. They don't really care sometimes about putting that team that, you know, a superstar like Carmelo Anthony needs around him. And speaking of Carmelo Anthony, I want to branch right off into him because he's another important point in this video. He had a free agent decision in 2014. And back then, the Bulls, they were primed to take him. Like, they had a perfect open spot for him. They had Derrick Rose. They had a great defensive team. All they needed was one more just superstar scorer to come in and take them to the next level. And we knew it. Carmelo Anthony knew it. And Carmelo Anthony was like, nah, I think I'm gonna chill over here with the Knicks. And it took a hell of a lot of money to do it. I don't remember the figures off the top of my head. But when he did that, you know, it seemed like a lose-lose situation because Carmelo Anthony had a choice. He could go to Chicago and almost surely contend for a championship, really, really throw his name in there. Or he could stay in New York and be loyal. Like, a lot of fans say they want that. They say they want these players to be like the old days and just stay where they are and try to win a championship there. But when Carmelo Anthony did that, all I saw was backlash. I saw that Carmelo Anthony doesn't care about winning, and oh, he just wants to, you know, shoot the ball and make money. And if he cared about winning, he would have went to Chicago. But if he would have went to Chicago, what would you have said? You would have said, oh, he's not loyal. Look at him. He wanted to trade from the Nuggets, and then he left the Knicks, and this guy is just a team hopper. So back to our scenario, if we're that player who has a free agency option, and we know this already, that it's basically a lose-lose situation with the fans, then you take that into consideration too. Like, well, you know, so far I'm seeing more cons than good staying with a franchise that might not be able to help me get where I want to go. Give you another example. Dwayne Wade just gave Miami like 13 great years of his life. You know, he was drafted there. He brought that team, they won 3 championships. Yeah, they won 3 titles in the span of 13 years. Some teams don't even make the finals 3 times in 13 years. Not only this, but to my knowledge, Dwayne Wade was never the top paid player on the Miami Heat. But what happened when, you know, he's 34 years old and his free agency time, it's time for free agency and, he's looking for a paycheck, and Pat Riley's like, you're 34 years old. And I'm not saying Pat Riley said this, but I'm just going through the thought process. The thought process of a businessman is, well, I'm not really going to pay a 34-year-old and tie up all my money in him. You know, I'm going to give him what I can, and we're going to keep building because it's about time. You know, he's 34. The reality is we love Dwayne, but we've got to find our next superstar. We've got to build our next team for the future. And Miami apparently put that over signing Dwayne Wade. And that's the reason Dwayne Wade is in Chicago today. You know, regardless if, you know, Dwayne Wade is saying this was a selfish move and he wanted to go to Chicago and you can't blame Pat Riley. Look, I don't claim to know everything, but I do claim to know one thing. And it's money talks. And if Miami would have paid Dwayne Wade what he wanted, he would still be in a Heat uniform and he would still be a Heat lifer. I just remember last summer he was yelling Heat lifer. That's what he said, right? So I don't think, you know, in that year he just all of a sudden wanted to go to Chicago. And Pat Riley, you know, he wasn't loyal to Dwayne Wade. Dwayne Wade, I mean, what else can you do if you're a player like Wade, right? What else can you do but take pay cuts? I mean, that's not just a basketball decision. That's a life decision, man. He took cuts, you know, so they could get that big three together in Miami. He did everything he could to make sure Miami was successful, played his heart out, and they didn't want to give him that thank you paycheck. So at the end of the day, Dwayne Wade had to go. And that's another thing you consider if you're that free agent looking at it. Is this team going to be loyal to me when it's time for them to make that decision? I think the last angle I want to take with this is what just happened with Derrick Rose. I mean, if you're like me, Derrick Rose looked like the type of player who was always going to be in Chicago. Like, I think a couple of months have passed. I'm pretty used to the fact that he's not there anymore. But I have this poster on my wall of Derrick Rose. And it's really weird because I'm looking at it and it's like, I always imagine him being in that Chicago Red. Why is he not in that Chicago Red? He's not in that Chicago Red because he wasn't doing what the team wanted him to do anymore. He won an MVP in 2011, and ever since then, that guy has been hurt. But he's been working his ass off every year trying to get back. no matter how many bad injuries this guy suffers, he seems to, you know, come right back next year. And, you know, he's physically still kind of looks good. I mean, he's not as athletic as he used to be, but at the beginning of some seasons, he's like, wow, did this guy just have a knee injury? He looks great. But what did we just see happen? The Bulls said, you know, time's up. D Rose is not doing for us what we need to anymore. They got rid of Rose. They traded him to the New York Knicks without even thinking about it. I mean, they did that quick too, because they were talking about, you know, Derrick Rose trade rumors, and I was like, man, what Derrick Rose trade? They're not trading Derrick Rose. And I was sitting at Starbucks, and I got a notification, Derrick Rose traded to the Knicks, and I about flipped. I was like, wow, they really traded this man. So my point with that is, 9 times out of 10, players are expendable to these franchises. So you do get some, like, LA. The Lakers gave Kobe Bryant his thank you. You know, they paid him all his money at the end of his career, and now they're doing whatever they need to do there. My point with this whole thing with Derrick Rose is that the minute that you're not what you need to be for a franchise, they're not going to have the same thoughts about you anymore. They're going to trade you. They're not going to be loyal to you, right? And I'm not saying every time a Dwayne Wade situation comes up, they're not going to pay you, because, I mean, they paid Kobe. But I just do that to tell you that more times than not, a franchise is not going to worry about being loyal to you. If they think that they can put themselves in a better position by changing the culture or trading you, they're going to do it. Look no further than Isaiah Thomas from the Pistons. I remember watching Open Court, and he was talking about how, yeah, one day the Pistons took him in, and they were like, yeah, you know, we're changing the culture around here. And he got pissed.
The Pistons killed me when they said they're going to change the culture.
That's just an example to show you. Teams do what's best for them. So why do we get mad at players for doing what's best for them? If LeBron James would have stayed in Cleveland after that 7 years, would he have a championship today? They wouldn't have drafted Kyrie Irving, and only God knows if they were ever actually going to get a free agent there. When he was in Cleveland for that 7 years, they couldn't get anybody. There were rumors that he was going to get Chris Bosh, but, you know, I don't think Chris Bosh really wanted to go play in Cleveland. So it's like, that's now been, what, the year's 2016. So it's been about 6 years since LeBron James made that decision. I think his career turned out for the best, because ever since LeBron James took control of his career and said, you know what, I'm going to do what's best for me, and if this team isn't with it, then I'm out. I mean, yeah, he switched teams and people haven't liked it, but the man has a huge legacy now. He's won championships, MVPs, finals MVPs. He's decorated. Kevin Durant just took control of his situation. He went to the Warriors. He's probably going to win championships. Granted, since the Warriors were already so good, he's probably not going to have much of a legacy because, you know, people say he took the cop-out thing. But the man is going to have rings. And I think we're going to see it a lot more often where players just say, you know what? It's really not a win for me to be loyal to an organization 9 times out of 10. Just to recap the points I made in this video to prove that, when you look at what Carmelo Anthony did, it was a lose-lose situation for him. He was going to get criticized for leaving. He was going to get criticized for staying. LeBron James has won so much since he took control of his own destiny. Gilbert Arenas talking about the owners saying, you know what, you're a great player, but sometimes you're on a team that just says, we don't really have to pay anybody to come play with you because we're already making the money we want. So to hell with your legacy, to hell with it if you ever win a championship. The owners, they're going to trade you. I remember Danny Ainge talking about how if the right deal came up, he was going to pull the trigger on our big three. Hell, he traded Ray Allen to Memphis, I remember. That trade, for whatever reason, just didn't go through. That made Ray Allen mad, and he took off on us for the Miami Heat and won another championship. Dwayne Wade took pay cuts, did everything he could for the Miami Heat, and they would not pay that man at the end of the day. So I guess what I'm saying with this video is that before we do any more player bashing and talking about how they should be loyal, think about the business side and think about the teams that you're talking about they should be loyal to. Because if you were an NBA superstar that was a free agent and you knew everything I just told you in this video, would you decide to be loyal to a franchise that, you know, might trade you or might not pay for the help around you, or, you know, hell, not pay you after you've done everything for them? They don't give you any money at the end of your career. Would you do that, or would you take control of your career and go win championships and get all the money that you can get somewhere else? What would you do? Because I know what I would do, and I would not sit around and wait for a team that might not ever get me the help I need or might trade me if I get injured or... You know, basically, like I said, loyalty is important to me in my life, and I know in my regular life, and probably in your guys' regular life too, you're not loyal to people who aren't loyal to you, are you? Think about it. These guys, you know, the teams aren't loyal to them sometimes, but we expect loyalty from them to the team. It's a backward system. So what would you guys do? You know, do you think players should be loyal to teams? You know, what's your whole take on the situation? Leave a comment about it. Thank you for watching, and I'll be back next video.